have some time for questions or discussion or something like that. So again, hello to everyone. It's so nice to see everyone here, your faces, your names, your presence. That's the most important. So we're not going to spend time on the on saying all the names, although we started with something that names are very important. So we know it's important. We're not saying everybody's name just because we want to have more time later. So, you know, I remember, and I sure all of us who went through that time or expecting grandkids or watching, right, when we were pregnant, you're thinking, oh, what name are you going to give? If it's a boy, it's a girl, especially when we don't know, it's perhaps exciting or nervous, or, you know, and then you think, will you give a name of a tzaddik or a tzaddiket, you know, somebody righteous, somebody from the Tanakh, from the Torah? You're going to give a name to your child. A name perhaps of family member who was very dear to you, who a loved one who unfortunately is not here anymore. And you know, there are many things we think about, and then the baby comes, and then sometimes we change our mind, or you look at the face of the baby, you look at the eyes, and many times you say, no, I think that's the name of the baby, right? Like you just have. And it says in the Torah that us as parents, we have the prophecy. There's a prophecy that is given to parents to decide the name of the child. And it's interesting because sometimes people tell me, you know, that some people give, like, if I may say, weird names, or they don't give Jewish names or what. I cannot say this is the prophecy that they were given, because probably when you speak with them or they think themselves, they had through their mind went through some names that could have been a Jewish name. And we spoke about it many times that Hashem is giving us blessings, right, and showing us the way, and sometimes we follow, it's our choice, and sometimes we decide to do something else. So we cannot say that, you know, they didn't have the prophecy in the Nevoah. At times, you know, if they follow, that they would get the right Nevoah, obviously, because we all want to have Jewish names for our children, special names. And it says in the Torah that that's how the spirituality, the channel, that everything comes through is through the names. Through the source comes through the name that the person has. Mm-hmm. And why are we mentioning it? Because as we know, the parsha of this week is Ve'ele Shmot Bnei Yisrael, Abayim Yitzrayim. These are the names. Shmot. In English, we call it Exodus. The second Chumash of the Torah is called Exodus in English. But in Hebrew is Shmot, Chumash Shmot. Shmot means Shemot. Shemot are names. Names are very important. The last parsha, Parshat Vayechid, we already know who came down to Mitzrayim. And here Hashem is saying again everybody's names. Names are very important. The name of a person, you know, when somebody's asleep, right? And you want to wake them up. And at times some people sleep very strong. I wish I had that. I wake up from every little thing, and I think some of us do. Some of us sleep strong. You say the name. When you call the name, it's the essence of the person. The person wakes up. Or God forbid, if somebody loses conscious, if somebody faints, then you call their name. You call them by their name really strong. And many times that helps to wake them up. And by the way, that's the reason that Hashem wanted the Baal Shem Tov. What was his name? Rabbi Yisroel Baal Shem Tov. Baal Shem Tov is the name of a master of the good name. But his first name was Israel. Why Israel? Like the Jewish people, Bnei Israel, because he lived in a town that was very difficult for the Jewish people. It says like the Jewish people were in a phase of ilafon, like they were all in a fainty phase. They were fainted. It was the time of the Cossacks. The Jewish people suffered a lot. It was a very, very difficult, depressed time. And we needed a leader that will come and wake them up from that and bring some happiness and shake them up and bring them back to life, as we say. And that's why Hashem brought Rabbi Yisroel Baal Shem Tov Israel, like to wake up the Jewish people in the spiritual and physical sense. And that's what the name is. A name is something very, very important. Why are we speaking about it? As we know, because the parsha's name and the Chumash is Shmot, a name speaks that every individual, we all have a different name. A name that speaks to us, even if two people have the same name, but the name is to us, we have different parents, different face, different how we look. Unfortunately, only a short generation ago, there was a nation that tried to take away the humanity, the dehumanize our nation, the Nazis. What did they do? They did not call us by names. I don't want to show on myself. They made tattoos, they made numbers on the people's arms, because every person all of a sudden wasn't a person. It was a, every person was a number. According to Torah, a person is not a number. These are the names. The Nazis tried to take away the unique thing that we have, that humans have. We have names, and that we are not numbers. And this is something that Chumash Shmot, the Exodus, teaching us, that in order to go out, in order to go out of Egypt, in order to go out to Exodus, the Exodus of Egypt, of Mitzrayim, of our own limitations, we have to realize that us and our friends around and all humans, we all have a unique purpose, a unique challenge as well, unique things that bother us, unique things that make us happy. And we are supposed to help each other by remembering that we are humans, to have respect and to treat ourselves, to treat each other with respect, with help as much as we can. This we learn from the first words of the Chumash and the whole name of the Parsha and the whole name of the whole Chumash of the second book of the Torah, Shmot, names. And name is very important. Each one is special. And Hashem always, as we know, we are not numbers. Whenever we count people, if you are aware, we say, you know, not one, not two, not three, not to do ayin hara. We say, we don't count people by numbers. People are not numbers. Or we say, Hoshia et Amecha. I don't know if you know the special verse, Hoshia et Amecha, means Hashem bring salvation to your people. It's a special verse in the Torah. Hoshia et Amecha, uvarech et nachalatecha, and bless your people. You know that verse, if you say each one, Hoshia et Amecha, uvarech et nachalatecha, urem venasem ad haolam. It's 10 words. And I don't know if you ever noticed that when people come to Davin, when men come to Davin, they want to see if they have a minion. So they instead of going at one or say the names, they go Hoshia et Amecha, uvarech et nachalatecha, you know, bless your people. We say it with a verse of the Torah, because if you finish the whole verse, then you know you have 10 people. If you're missing two words, then you have 8, or so on and so forth. So names are important, and each individual is important, and we have to have respect and learn from each other and respect each other. And as we know, today's, you're still here, right? I just have another picture all of a sudden here, but you can still hear me? Yeah, okay. I don't know why the picture here changed. The class today that we called is Women as Leaders. And to go through the Parsha, in short, this Parsha speaks about a very special leader, as we know, somebody who was born in this Parsha, the birth of a leader of very easy, we all know, Moshe Rabbeinu, Moses. So let's try just to make the story just to remind all of us the story of the parasha. And again, hello and welcome everyone. So the story of the parasha, the Jewish people went to Egypt. They were there, they multiplied. Hashem wanted the Jewish people to be many. And now it wasn't just a family of Yaakov, it became a whole nation. As we know, the Torah tells us that Hashem made a miracle. And every time a woman gave birth, she had 6 children at once. However you call it, quartuples, I don't know the word that you say. As I remember, as children, we would learn it, we would think, oh, so if we have 5 kids in the family, we would have 30, because every time mom had a baby, it would be times 6. Or if you have 7 kids, it would be 35, you know, and so on and so forth. And Paro got scared. He didn't know what to do. He saw that the Jewish people would come more, and he decided to enslave them. Yosef died, and all the Shvatim, all the tribes, all the people, Yaakov, everybody, and now it was a new Pharaoh. There are 2 commentaries. Either it was a new Pharaoh, the old Pharaoh died, that didn't remember Yosef, and all the good things that Yosef brought to Egypt, how he saved the whole land. And the other commentary is that it was the same, but he made himself, he doesn't know Yosef, he doesn't know what the Jewish people had, all the contribution of Yosef to the country. And he decided to enslave the Jewish people. And they suffered a lot. It was terrible. The Pharaoh had leprosy. So his people said, oh, you know, in order for you to get rid of it, you have to take bath. And I know it sounds terrible, in blood of Jewish children. And yeah, he would fill whole baths of with blood of Jewish children and bathe in it to help his leprosy. It was a lot of, you know, they had to work a whole day. They would be beaten. They would be killed. It was a very difficult time. Very, very, very difficult time. And Moshe was born during that time. And now what happens? How was Moshe born? We know that they had to work. And then one day they decided, the Egyptians, that they're the smart people, you know, the people who used to gaze in them, a stargazer, that told Pharaoh, you have to try to get rid of the Jews, and there will be a male, a boy that will be born, and he will take all the Jewish people out of Egypt. So you're not gonna have any more the Hebrew slaves for you. So he said, okay, how do I know who it is? They said, we don't know who it is. So what did he say? He made a decree that every Jewish boy that is born, the minute he is born, to murder the baby right away. The minute the baby is born, to murder the baby. And what did he do? He asked two Jewish midwives to kill the babies as the babies are born. And it was terrible. And the girls, he said, you can let leave. How can you let the girls leave? Not let them leave as Jewish girls, but make them, assimilate them in the culture of Egypt. So basically like to finish the Jewish people, God forbid, slowly but slowly, not to have any male, and the women should be, the little girls should be drowned into the culture of Egypt, and then there will be no Jewish people. Amram, who was then the leader of the Jewish people, he was a very holy man, he said, what should we do? He didn't want to bring children to the world that they should be killed, be murdered the minute after they're born, 50% of them anyway, if they're boys. So he decided to divorce his wife because he says, I can't bring children to the world anyway. I don't want to bring children that should be killed. And because as he was the leader, the other men followed suit. And then his young daughter, Miriam, told him, Father, what are you doing? Hashem, Pharaoh is killing the boys, but by you, the way you act, and then everybody learned from you, by you not being married, we're not going to have even Jewish girls, and so on and so forth. And Amram listened to her and came back to his wife, married her back again, and that's how everybody else did. And from that, Moshe was born. From that time, Moshe was born. Now, Moshe was born a little bit early. And as we know, Yocheved hid him for 3 months, and then she didn't want him to be killed, and she put him in the basket by the river. And then the daughter of Pharaoh came, and then Miriam, the sister, stood there, and the whole thing. She was saved, Moshe was saved, and so on and so forth. This is in short what we're learning. Now let's try to understand a little bit more, and that's where we're getting to the women as leaders. Want to learn from that. It's true in this Parsha is the birth of an amazing leader, Moshe. We know that Moshe Rabbeinu did everything and anything he can for the Jewish people. And we see it from the first moment when he came out, when he grew up, as we know he grew up in that, we'll speak about it soon a little bit more, in Pharaoh's home, but he knew he was a Jewish man, Jewish boy. And when he went out to see his enslaved, suffering brothers and sisters, his enslaved Jewish people, and then he saw, as we know, he saw an Egyptian beating up a Hebrew slave, a Jewish man, and he knew that it was a crime. And here he could have not mind, he could have mind his own business and go away. But from here we see that he was a true leader. He knew that he can get hurt, and he was caught, and he almost was killed by Paro. But he saw a crime, a scene of a crime. He saw somebody innocent that is suffering. So he came up to the scene and he took care to take away the person who was suffering and to put away to bring the justice, the person who was wrong, take him away, and he saved the innocent person. There were many incidents of that happened over and over that you can see that he was a true leader, that he wanted to make sure to protect the people no matter what causes it to him. This is what a true leader is. He doesn't do, or she doesn't do what's good for her, but she or he do what's good for the people around, what the people need. Later on at the burning bush, as we know, when God appeared himself in the burning bush to Moshe, and he told him, I want you to go and take out the Jewish people. And if we remember, those of us who studied the Parsha, Moshe said, no, I'm this, I cannot speak well. Because we know Moshe was stuttering. I don't know if we'll have time this time, maybe another time to speak about the story. Why was Moshe stuttering? He wasn't born like that. And Moshe was a special need. As far as when we spoke, it was hard for him to speak. Then he said, do this. And he found all kinds of excuses that he doesn't want to be the leader. He doesn't want to be the one to take the Jewish people out of Egypt. There's somebody better, there's somebody this. Still, Hashem actually got upset with him, and he says, you know, you have to do it. And this is also a sign of a leader, because a true leader is not leading because he's looking for himself, you know, to be famous and everybody. He's doing it because he has to do it. And Moshe saw that Hashem really wanted him to do it. He wasn't giving him a job to make him feel good, but he really wanted him to do it. And he has the strength. God is giving him the strength to take the Jewish people out of exile, to take the Jewish people out of suffering. He obviously decided to do it, and he went ahead to do it. Now let's see a little bit more, as I said, beneath the story. So we will speak about the women who were around Moshe's life and around Moshe's birth and Moshe's life. And obviously Moshe Rabbeinu had to be born, and things had to be how they had to be. But we see that it came all with the help of Jewish women. And if they weren't there, then we are not sure exactly how the story would happen, but it would happen probably in a different way. First thing is, as I mentioned before, about his birth. Here you have a young child, a young prophetess, Miriam. Miriam was a young child. She lived in very difficult times. As we can say, time of the Holocaust. People could not be at home. Men were always working. Women had to work as well, enslaved work. They would take, when people had to, Paro gave the Jewish people a certain amount of bricks, a certain amount of wall bricks that they had to make every day. Every time they had different laws, like kill the Jewish boys, then bathe in Jewish blood of kids, God forbid. Then there was that one that they had to build a wall. And if they didn't finish to do it, or certain amount of bricks in the end of the day, what would they do? They would go to this person's home and they would take their infants, their babies, their children, and they would put it in the wall instead of the brick. So they would take an alive child, God forbid, and it's very hard to describe, and put it in and close it with, and you know, with whatever you close a wall. And they went through so much, and this little girl seen it. They knew it, they lived in it. And here all of a sudden her father, who was the leader of the Jewish people, goes away from her mom, and he says, you know what, we don't want to be together anymore, we don't want to be married, because then we're going to have children, and those children are going to die, and it's such a dark world, why should we bring children that they're going to be killed the first moment they go out, and they breathe the fresh air, and they're going to be murdered right away. And it was terrible. But she saw the future. Even though she was a young girl, she was already a prophetess, and she saw something, as we learned many times, that the women saw beyond the men. She saw something that she had to tell her father, the leader. And her father was such a great man that he wasn't up to, oh, why should I listen? He listened to her. He understood she was right. And he said, Father, we cannot do that. Hashem will take us out of Egypt. And Paro made that decree, but God willing, it'll go away. And at least Jewish girls should be born the way you did it, that you are not married to mom and everybody else followed suit, then Jewish girls will not be born also. And she convinced him, she explained to him, and that brought a lot of more moral support, and Moshe was born. And shortly after, that decree was nullified. Now, when Moshe was born, so here is Miriam. We're gonna see soon what Miriam, what else she had, her role was as a leader in this, in the life of the great leader Moshe Rabbeinu, that took us out of Egypt, that will take us out of this last galut, that the Torah is all the time Moshe, 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 that it was so great, so selfless, so amazing, and so much that he helped us, so many qualities, so many things that we learned from him, and so on. Yocheved was the mother. She was the wife of Amram, the mother of Moshe. She was a selfless woman. She had this child. She did anything she can to continue. And she decided that she's got to save him. She had many, many amazing qualities in her, leadership qualities as well, how she raised her kids. And it's amazing when you think about Amram and Yocheved. Yocheved was a mother to three great leaders. There were three children of hers. Aharon, Miriam, as far as I know, I think Miriam was the oldest. Miriam, Aharon, and Moshe. Aharon was 3 years older than Moshe, and Miriam was 2.5 or 3 years older than Aharon and Moshe. So, because she was about 5 when she told her father, then by the time Moshe was born, she was 6, and it's known that Moshe was 80 and Aharon was 83 when they were going out of Egypt. So she was the oldest. She was the mother of three great, great leaders. She had to have those leadership skills to give it to her children. She has this child. The child was born, there was light in the house. He was born a little bit early, a few months early, 3 months early. And she was hoping she can hide him for 3 months. Why? Because the Egyptians were terrible. They knew that the Jewish people used to hide their baby boys. They would put them in different places in the house. And what the Egyptians did, they would follow, they would go after people if they knew people got married, and here they knew the people got divorced or whatever, they got together again. So they followed certain families to see if they saw women were pregnant when they would have a child. So she knew that for a few more months, she is still safe. She would stay at home. Nobody would see that she already had the baby, and she can save him at home. She can hide him, because what they would do is they would go into a house and ask, where is the baby? Obviously the baby would be hidden. Sometimes the baby just starts crying. But what they used to do, the Medrash is telling us, that they would bring an Egyptian baby into the Jewish homes, and they would hit the Egyptian's baby, smack the baby on the face or so, the baby starts crying. And when another baby, you know that when a baby listens to another baby cry long enough, they start crying also, just naturally. I guess they feel for someone else. So they would hear, they would find the hiding place. So Yocheved knew that she can't hide the baby any longer. So what did she do? She put him in a basket. She was hoping that she will do whatever she can. She was hoping that Hashem will save the baby somehow. Something will come. Let's see what we can do. But by her leaving the baby at home, for sure, nothing is going to happen. And then who comes to the rescue? Who comes to watch the child, the little six-year-old sister? So the mother puts the baby in the basket, obviously not by the water, but by the reeds of the water, like the tall grass. And Miriam stood from far. And here she is standing from far, and she's praying. She's saying, Hashem, you know, Baruch Hashem, all the families got together. We're having children. Please save this child. Save this little brother of mine. Let's see what we can do to save the child. Let's hope that the child is not going to be thrown away, not going to be put to death. And here we are, just imagine, at the water. Miriam is staying far. The mother is not there. And Miriam is hiding as a young girl. She wasn't as large, as big. And all of a sudden, who is coming to bathe at the Nile River? The daughter of Paro, Bat Paro, royalty, is coming to bathe at the river. And she's coming not on her own. She's coming with her female slaves, with her narot, with her girls that help her, obviously. As a princess, she won't go on her own. And here we are. She's standing there, and she's looking, and she sees from far a basket. And she hears a baby cry. And the first thing it says that she heard a child cry, and she had those human instincts, like every normal human being. Wow, I feel bad. A child is crying. Let me help it. Why did somebody put a baby there? And then she's looking, thinking a little bit more. She's thinking, oh, probably because my father is probably one of the Hebrew slaves' babies. He probably one of the those little children that my father said to kill, and they're trying to save. So first she has this human instinct from her heart, and now she's thinking, well, is that child? And as we know, there are different interpretations that she stretched out her arm, and her arm became long enough that she was able to bring to get the basket, or she sent her maid servant. She went into the water, she brought the basket, she opened up, she says, yeah, it's a Hebrew, you know, a baby, and so on and so forth. And she wants to save the child. And now we see here the big leadership role. I know many times we read the stories of the Torah, we don't dwell in it. And here what we see, imagine she is royalty, the daughter of royalty of who? Of a tyrant, of a terrible king of Pharaoh. Imagine that she is the daughter of Eichmann, of Haman, of Hitler. That's who her father was. A terrible, of Achashverosh, a terrible, terrible person. And here she is, and she's going against it. She wants to save the child. She is this big hero. She's going against the rule of the country, against royalty, against her father, because she knows he's wrong. She doesn't know what's going to happen to her. She's not doing it on her own. She has witnesses. She's there. She's trying to save the child. Who sees everything? Never mind Miriam. She doesn't know that Miriam is there yet, right? Her maidservant, one or two, however many she had there. Even just one. What happens if in a few months she gets angry at the princess, or she just decides to sell gossip and say, you know, the princess saved one of the Hebrew babies, one of the Hebrew slaves' children, that King Pharaoh, that her father said everybody had to be killed, and she saved. Like, she was, as we know, those terrible kings had no feelings, had no human, nothing. Even if their own children, their own spouses, their own this, they would kill. Stalin, all this. They were so afraid for power that they were so, you know, that she knew that she can have a bitter end. As, you know, who knows, like I said, if she was the daughter of Hitler, if he knew if he would allow his daughter to save Jewish kids. And she still did it. She still took the child, and the child was crying. So the child is hungry, right? The child wanted to nurse. It was a 3-month-old baby, Moshe. He wanted to nurse, just like every normal child. And she took the baby to some of the, you know, ladies that were there, and the ones that had babies as well that were nursing their babies. So she asked them, can you nurse the baby? And it's amazing, amazing, amazing. Moshe was such a holy person, a holy child since he was a baby, that God did not allow him. He didn't want, he wouldn't open his mouth. He wouldn't nurse from the non-Jewish women, because his mouth was going to speak to the Shekhinah, to the divine presence. His mouth was going to speak to Hashem, so he couldn't contaminate his mouth with not kosher milk, because if she's not a Jewish person, then, you know, I mean, not that we don't sell Jewish, you know, human milk, but you understand what I'm saying. He needed a Jewish mother to nurse him, like one of us. She didn't know what to do. And here Miriam decided to jump. Here's a young child. And she comes up and she tells Batya, Your Highness, she says, you know, maybe I can help you, because I see the child is not eating. I might be able to go find some lady that just had a baby, that she's nursing her child, and perhaps she'll come and she'll take this baby to nurse this baby. Obviously, she didn't say who she wanted to call. And here you see how brilliant she was. She came, this story, you know, when you think about all the details, she had this brilliant idea. The baby is not sucking from everyone. Let me go call my mother. They will not know it's my mother. Meanwhile, my mother will be able to be with my little brother and will save my my child in here, and you know, and the whole thing will be saved, the Moshe will be saved, and so on and so forth. And now let's think. We're standing by the Nile, by the water. There are two people standing here, very different in stature, this is a six-year-old little girl. This Batya's daughter, I don't know, but she was older. Here she is a princess of royalty. Obviously she wasn't a slave. She was considered a slave, but here was a child who was a Jewish girl. But what was the same? They were both leaders that they wanted to save a person's life, a little Jewish boy's life. And Batya, it wasn't not up to her honor. Here's a little kid coming to give me a good advice. Why should I listen to her? She thought, yeah, because the common denominator was the same. We want to save someone. We want to help. Doesn't matter who we are. And just reminds us so many stories of the Holocaust. When I was reading and I was thinking about it, how many great people that put their life in danger, and many of them were killed after. They were caught. Many they, on the outside, they were like Nazis, many German people, many other nations people, Polish and so on and so forth, that on the outside, they showed themselves that they didn't like the Jews and they were okay with the Nazis. And in hiding, they saved one child after another, one person after another, whether adults or children, whoever they were able to, they saved, because they went here against the law of the land. Something that came into, I forgot the name of the person in America, Henry, I forgot his last name, that came up when was the Eichmann's and Nuremberg trial and all those trials, that they said that what many heroes of the Holocaust, what they have done is that they went against the laws of the land in order to, because they were human, in order to save humans, in order to be, they had the conscious to be kind, to do the right thing. And they didn't say, well, that's the rule of the land, so we're gonna go kill everybody, because they knew it was wrong. And we know that we follow the rules of the land when it's right. But if it's not just, God forbid, thank goodness we live in a very good country. Baruch Hashem, Baruch Hashem, Baruch Hashem. But our ancestors did not live in such good countries. And special time of Egypt and so on, we lived in times that many times we were told to do things that were against Torah, were against humanity, against justice. And we had to stand up, and many times we would get caught and we would be put to justice. We had to pay for it, for being human, like people did in the Holocaust. They went against because they wanted to save people. Who was really the first person, one of the first people to do it? It was Batya, the daughter of Paro, and she was given that name, Batya, the daughter of Hashem. There's so many more things that we can learn that we're just not gonna have time, because I wanna leave some time for question and answers. Also, that the name that Batya gave Moshe, that's the name that the Egyptian lady, she was a very special person, because here she lived in such a place, as we said, just imagine she was the daughter of Hitler, daughter of any of those terrible people. And here she went against, she risked her life, and then she took the child and he grew up in her house and so on. She protected him and he was the leader. Here Paro was killing, wanted to kill other boys. In the end, he was raising his own leader in his own house. And she did it all because she knew, even though she was the princess, even though her father said to do something, but she knew it was wrong. It was against humanity. It was not the right thing. And she wasn't going to follow. She was going to do what the right thing to do. And she listened to Miriam. And here, two people standing by the Nile River, so different, but when they came together, they accomplished to nurture such a great person as Moshe Rabbeinu, that later helped millions of people to go out of Egypt, brought them hope and help and salvation and so on and so forth. So we spoke a little bit about Batya, the princess. We're speaking today about Jewish leaders, right? Jewish women. We spoke about Miriam, how she influenced her father and the Jewish people, how she helped here. She made a whole cover story. It's like amazing. She decided to go call her mother. Nobody knew, and her mother nursed Moshe for 2 years. It was the custom. And then later she brought him to Batya's home, and Batya checked on him, and obviously she didn't say she was the mother. She just, Batya paid her, thanked her, you know, that she took care of that child, that Batya said, it's Batya, the daughter of Paro, is my child. And it's very interesting. I think Batya is, I mean, it says Batya, I mean, the daughter of Hashem. You can think it's a name of of Egyptian princess, but it's a beautiful name. Many Jewish people have it. And in Ashkenazic name, you would say Basia. And you have many girls that are Basi, Basia. I don't know if you heard that name, Batia, Basia. Many people have that name, and it's a very beautiful, beautiful name that she deserved to have. And now we'll speak about the other women, that Shifra and Pua. Shifra and Pua, there are two commentaries, some that they were midwives. And Rashi says that they were the same as Yocheved and Miriam. Yocheved, the mother of Moshe, and Miriam, the sister of Moshe. So what happened? Paro wanted to kill all the Jewish babies. It was hard to go from house to house, how I explained to you that they tried to do to get the babies after they're born, because the Jews tried to hide them. And even though they found some, but many escaped, and they didn't get to kill everyone. So they had a new idea. They said they're going to go speak to the Jewish midwives, and they will tell them to kill the babies the minute the babies are born. And then they will tell the mother that they had a hard birth, whatever, and the baby was born stillborn, God forbid. The babies died. They didn't kill it. That's what happened. And again, it's just like the Holocaust. And here are two brave women. They know if they are not going to listen, their life is at stake. But they weren't going to kill Jewish babies the minute the babies are born, or a minute later, or the opposite. They used to nurture the babies. They used to help the Jewish women because the men were working. They used to feed them and breed them, and whatever the Jewish midwives did, whatever they were able to do to help the women raise those children. Those were the children that later on went out of Egypt. Those were the children that were called Tzivot Hashem, as the Rebbe is saying, says in the Torah, Tzivot Hashem, the army of Hashem. They crossed the Yam Suf. They saw Hashem. They said, Az Yashir Moshe, they said, the Shira. This was the generation that went out of Egypt that entered Israel. They were very special people. And all that generation was born. Why? Because the little leader, the little prophetess Miriam, she knew that good will come. And she basically told off her father in a nice way that it's wrong. And she convinced him to go back. And Moshe was born. And so many thousands and thousands of more children were born that were the future of the next generation. And here, they cannot do it. What should they do? Can somebody go and explain to Eichmann or to Hitler that you can't kill Jewish babies? They know there's nothing they can do to explain. So they came up, and thank goodness they were able to, they came up with an idea. Paro saw that the Jewish babies are still alive. So he called him, he said, why don't you kill Jewish babies? And they said, well, you know, we can't do anything. These women have their babies, they call us to come, but they have the babies like animals in the wild, you know, like animals, they don't need any intervention, they don't need any help to have babies. When they have babies, they do it on their own. We humans need help. Animals know how to do it on their own. So they said those women, they're like animals. And it's true because, I mean, we are compared to many special animals, as we know that when Yaakov gave the bracha to his sons, many of the sons were Gur Aryeh Yehuda. Yehuda was like a lion, and Binyamin is Ze'ev, is a wolf, and there was Ayala Shlucha, a deer, is Naphtali. Many of them were Issachar, Chamor Gerem is like a donkey, you know, compared special qualities that animals have that the tribe should have, you know, the special things and so on and so forth. So he said, you know, these women, they are like, they're like animals in the wild. When we come to help them, they already had their baby. They're already holding their baby. Then we can't do anything. You're telling us to kill the babies the minute they're born before the mother can get a hold of them. But by the time we come, obviously Paro understood that they're trying to be, but he couldn't punish them. Thank goodness he did not punish them. And they were rewarded. Both Yocheved and Miriam were rewarded because they sacrificed their life. Paro could have taken their life, but them coming and saying to this big tyrant that they are not killing the babies because they are like animals in the wild, they're having their own babies. And from Yocheved and Miriam came out the Kohanim and the Levim, right? Aaron and Moshe, Aaron the Kihuna and Moshe the Levim and the rest of the tribe Levim, also from Miriam. So here we see again amazing leadership skills that they had. They didn't care for themselves, but they did what they were supposed to do. And the other women in, I'm looking just at my time, we'll try to make it faster. The other woman in Moshe's life. So here, as you see, we brought, we're speaking about a Jewish leader, Moshe Rabbeinu, how so many or a few women around his life, how they helped him to be the leader he was and how they saved and what they have done. And we're doing it very short because there's so much more to speak. Zipporah, she was from Midian, right? She was also a very special person there. She could have stayed there. She had her two boys. She could have stayed with her father's family. She decided to follow Moshe to come to Mitzrayim, right? Because they were married, they lived in Midian. When we're going a little bit quick, perhaps couldn't say the whole story of the Parsha, but Moshe ran away, just to make it clear for some of us who are not so familiar with the Parsha. Moshe grew up, he was a leader, he did things, whatever he was able to save Jewish people. And one of the times when he killed an Egyptian that was hitting a Jewish slave, a Jewish man so much, and he couldn't get rid of him, he did not kill him by hurting him, he just said Hashem's name. He didn't do anything with his hands. And that person died from that power because he hurt so many Jews and he deserved to die. But then somebody had said to, then he saw two Jewish people fight, whatever. Power found out that Moshe did it because Moshe stood there and all of a sudden the Egyptian dropped dead, even though Moshe did not do anything with his hands to hurt him. And Moshe had to run away for his life. Moshe ran away. I mean, Paro tried to cut his neck. He became strong, whatever. There's many, many things what happened. In the end, they became blind. Paro ran away. Many miracles happened through that journey. Moshe ran away. I'm sorry, he got to Midian. And then in Midian, he met Yitro. He met the girls, the Yitro's daughters, and he married Zipporah. And obviously, Zipporah converted. Zipporah was a very, very special, beautiful person inside and outside. And she decided to go with Moshe. She didn't have to. She could have stayed and live in liberty and said to Moshe, okay, you want to go to the people to in Egypt? But she knew she's going to a place when there's not enough food, not enough place. The Jewish people are suffering. They're slaves. Very, very difficult life. But she wasn't going to leave her husband alone. She wanted to be there to lead the Jewish people with them, to be there to help whatever she can. And not to escape. That's what true leaders are. Not to escape from the situation, but to be where you have to be to help. Hopefully I'll remember. If not, remind me about a story about the Rebbe and Ariel Sharon, Arik Sharon, about the difference between the Tzava, you know, the Tzava, the Tzal in Israel, and armies around the Israeli army and armies around the world. What a true leader is by the Jewish people. And when they were going, as we know, Moshe did not make a bris to one of the, because one of the babies, one of his children was born on the way, and he didn't want to make him a bris. He was afraid that it will hurt him, right? It will be a danger. Anyway, a snake met them on the way. And the snake, it was a Hashem sent like a snake to punish Moshe for not making a circumcision to his son. And Moshe didn't know what to do. The snake, a serpent, whatever, swallowed Moshe from his head till the place where you have to make a bris, where you make a brit milah, and would spit him out, and then from the feet, like back and forth. And nobody knew what to do. And here, Zipporah came as a leader. She had that insight, and she saw something even more than Moshe saw, and she understood that it's because they did not make a bris to their son. So she took a knife and she made a bris right away to her little son. And that serpent, that snake disappeared, and she basically saved Moshe. She saved Moshe Rabbeinu. Here he is again, another woman. This is just part of the small qualities that I'm saying about Zipporah, but something amazing that she have seen, she understood, and she decided to take action to her hands and act at the spur of the moment to do the right thing, what has to be right, the thing that has to be right, what we have to do. And We have many more what to discuss women as leaders. One of the girls here asked me as well, wrote me an email that would be nice if we can spend some of our classes discussing about special women, but we speak many times about special rebbes, Chabad rebbes that were so special and special things about their lives. And I do want to mention that tonight and tomorrow is the Yortzeit of the Alter Rebbe, the Rebbe who wrote the Tanya, Reb Shneur Zalman, a very special time. He had a very special Rebbetzin, he had very special daughters. It's known that there was Hasidic discourses that he would say to his daughters only. And his son, who was later became the Rebbe, would hide many times under the table or hide in a closet behind the door because he wanted to hear it, because his father would say such lofty, amazing Hasidic Kabbalah discourses to his daughters. They were very special girls. So we will try from time to time to learn about that as well, which is very special to see the leaders in Jewish women. But I wanted to end the class with, and then we open a little bit of time for question and answers or discussion. As leaders, what is a leader? A leader, we think many times, and many times when we look at it as well, we think many men are leaders. Because they are prime ministers, presidents, mayors, CEOs, so on and so forth. Many times those leaders, they give us orders, if I may. They make rules, but it's by force. We listen, we obey, because we have no choice. Then we have many leaders that are true leaders, but they don't have any special titles, but they are true leaders. And they make so many changes in humanity, in the world, in our lives forever. Let's think about Maimonides, about the Rambam. Was he a king? Was he any specific? Yeah, he was a special rabbi in his time, but I don't know if something, look what he had left for generation, look his legacy. Look what he has done. When we look through history, we see many men and women, many prophetess, Ruth, Yael, Dvorah, Miriam, many that maybe they weren't leaders as we think that they told everybody what to do, but the things we learned from them. Leadership is not by force. True leaders are people who lead by example, people who are role models, people who we listen to. We can be we are leaders as being Jewish women in our homes, in our families, as many times we said and we say over and over, especially now that we're learning about the Exodus of Egypt, that it says that because of Jewish women, the Jewish people left Egypt. And one of the things I didn't mention before when we spoke about names, it says, unfortunately, the Jewish people were very assimilated in the culture of Egypt. They lived there for so many years. It was difficult. They were enslaved. They couldn't learn. They couldn't go to school. It was hard to pass on. And they were assimilated in many, many ways. But there were three things that they were kept very strong. And it was because of the Jewish women that kept it so strong also. They did not change their names. Shmam, and this is very important, the Shem, your name. They kept their Jewish names. They kept their language, Leshonam, Shmam, their language. They spoke the Hebrew language, not just Egyptian. So they knew their language. They knew that they were different, their names, the language, Un Levusham, and their clothing, the way they dressed, the way they were dressed with the hats, with the tzitzit, with the modesty. Those things they kept, their names, their language, and their attire, the way they dress like Jewish people. And those things kept them strong, that they were different than the Egyptians. And in the end, God did make them go out. So before we open for questions and answers, I hope we all understood women as Jewish leaders. We brought the women that were around. We brought just a little bit of their strength, how they fought, what they did, how strong they were. They were that they fought against somebody like Paro, I guess somebody who wanted to murder somebody, and they lived in such hard time because they knew the right thing to do. And that all made Moshe stronger. It all had an effect on Moshe's life. And that's what a true leader is. It's not somebody who gives rules what to do. A true leader is somebody who we want to listen to, who we learn ourselves from. And we all have to be those leaders. not by telling our kids what to do. As we said many times, it doesn't always work. It never works when the kids get older, when they're young. I mean, obviously we have to tell in a nice way, but by example, by being a role model. When we light the Shabbos candles, when we tell kids, you know, I went to mikvah, although I didn't go to mikvah when I was young because I didn't know about it. And now I'm after menopause and I'm 50, I'm 60, I'm even 70. I still decided to go to mikvah. That will make such a big effect on your teenage daughter or your young adult daughter or your married daughter or daughter-in-law or so on, because you still did that and so on and so forth. I do challah, I do this, I pray, I try not to pick up the phone, but whatever, you can just share. This is a true leader, not by forcing like prime ministers or like police. This is leaders by force, but true leaders are by example. So we're going to open the mics. You can open your mics, girls, and we can speak. We know also that this Shabbat, I do want to say, is that we're blessing the month. Tomorrow is the 24th of the month, Chavdalet Tevet. As I said, the Yorsa of the Alter Rebbe. Shabbos is the 25th. And Rosh Chodesh is, I guess, sometime towards the end of the week, will be Rosh Chodesh Shvat. I don't know exactly where it's on Shabbos. I didn't look at the calendar, but I do know it's Shabbat Mevarchim, the Shabbat that we bless the new month. And we should be blessed with a very, very good month. Healthy month first. And month of Geulah, month of redemption, month of Mashiach. Please, Holly, Susie, Eugenia, Sandy, I don't know, Risha, whoever, trying to see your names. Please, somebody to read, somebody wants to share something, so somebody wants to ask something. Thank you, Loredana. Amen is right. We still have a few minutes. Big shoes to fill, right? Of Miriam, of Yocheved, mm-hmm. of Batya. I read as well, girls, that it says in the Medrash there were 9 people. I don't remember all who they were. I know one of them was Eliyahu Hanavi. There were 9 people that went alive to Gan Eden, to paradise. They didn't die and then go. They went alive. And one of them says was Batya, the daughter of Paro.
Oh, wow.
Because of her heroic act, who she was. And that's what I tried to explain to you a little bit. I know we think Paro, yeah, it happened many years ago. The Jewish people worked. Unfortunately, that we heard and we know, and some of the people here, like Miss Vedro, had it on their own skin, that thing of the Holocaust, but we all know it was just a generation ago. And we all had grandparents and this that went through it. And like I said, imagine if she was the daughter of Hitler and she did something like that. Not for 1 minute, for many years. That was very special.
You know, Rochel, I studied all this in school. I went to a Jewish school in Mexico. But it never occurred to me, you know, the way that you presented is really special.
Thank you, Alice. And I have to say as well that it never occurred to me as well to the how special it is till I had to prepare for the class. And I want to thank also Eugenia that she sent me, as we all know, that Rabbi Jonathan Sacks passed away, the one from England. He was an amazing leader, an amazing person. Yeah. And some of the... And then there's a website is going with his classes. So some of that stuff I took from him, from his teachings and from the Rebbe. We try every night, me and my husband, we try to listen to a Rebbe Sicha in Yiddish that the Rebbe says about the Parsha. And the Rebbe spoke a lot about Jewish women, about Shmot, about Miriam and Yocheved, the strength, how a little girl changed so much of history and brought to the birth of the Redeemer of the Jewish people, you know, because many times we think male, and then we have to see the Rebbe brought up the women around. And as I said, leaders, it doesn't have to be loud and strong and have to be a prime minister, have to be a big CEO to be a leader. No, you can be a leader in a quiet way and accomplish so much more by being quiet and nice and not by force and by, you know, by people being afraid of me. But thank you, Alice, right? Yeah. Now we appreciate more. And I think that's a nice thing when we study Torah, as we get older, a little bit more in depth and trying, right? Put ourselves into the shoes and trying to imagine, you know, like when I was reading and I was thinking, right, you know, you're standing by the river and here is a princess of royalty. Miriam didn't know if she's a good lady, not a good lady. And here's a little girl comes and she has this idea and she, imagine how scared she was to speak to this highness, to this And then all of a sudden she saw she was human. She didn't care who she was. A little girl is giving her a good idea, sure, because she wanted to be human. She wanted to save human life. She wanted to be kind, and how they both were able to do it, how they were both able to connect, how when we want, we have the genius ideas. We just have to want, and we have to carry it out. And it's amazing how they both did it. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, I think it's very important to understand that there is a special path for the, a different path, let's say, for the leadership, like you were saying today. Because I feel it's very sad that sometimes people don't understand that, that they think some ladies think to be a leader to be men, so act like men, dress like men, say of color jokes. But I think to understand that you could be a leader but follow your own feminine path, a unique path that's also very effective.
Extremely effective. And that's very good. Thank you, Gina. What we said in the beginning of the class, we all have a name. Each one has a unique thing to do. Each one, men and women, God created us, and God wants each one of us to do whatever we need to do. This is a beautiful story that I will hopefully try to remember to share next week that speaks about how each one of us has to be proud with what we have to do and not what somebody else has to do. And whatever we were born, men or women, 100%. And there were, and as I mentioned, Rambam was such a great influence. But in his lifetime, was he a big king, a big ruler, a big this? Not necessarily. Later on, it came.
Rachel, you mentioned about a story that you wanted to share with Ariel Sharon.
All right. Yeah, thank you for reminding me. So I'll share that quickly. One of the times that Ariel Sharon and Arik Sharon had a private audience, Yechidut, with the Rebbe, they were discussing about Tzahal and Tzava and things in Israel. As we know, the Rebbe loved Eretz Israel. He loved everything was going on. He was so involved and he knew every detail, which was amazing to the details that the Rebbe knew. And the Rebbe asked him once, they were discussing something with Tzahal, and the Rebbe said, it was an answer when Ariel Sharon told the Rebbe, you love Israel so much. You love so much Eretz Israel. Why don't you move? Why do you live in New York? Why do you live? So he told him, what is the difference between the Israeli army and other armies? He said, no difference. Going on and on. He said, no, you know, they went to different tactics. Anyway, to make the long story short, the Rebbe told him, no, in one thing there is. He says, what happens when a plane, God forbid, crashes? The chief is on the plane, the commander, the general, is on the plane. Does he take his parachute and fly first? Or he saves all the soldiers, all the people, all the whoever is on the plane, and he's the last one to go? And Ariel Sharon said, you're right. You know, other armies, the generals save themselves first and then tell everybody, acharai, come after me. But here he saves everybody first. Usually when they go to war, when they have to go, God forbid, to a battle, in other armies, they tell the soldiers, you go first, you get killed first, and then we go. And as we know, and but in Tzal it's not about Jewish people, it's not that we know, there were many very good commanders, very good ktsinim that were so special that were killed in battle because they went first. They go first and tell everybody, acharai, come after me. But the Rebbe said there is in one incident, he sent everybody first. That's what Ariel Sharon couldn't remember. And the Rebbe said, what happens if a boat is sinking or a plane, God forbid, is falling down? The general doesn't go first. He doesn't say, acharai, come after me. He says, you be safe first. And he leaves his life for last, to save himself last. And that's what the Rebbe said. Rebbe told Ariel Sharon that I feel that I can basically have much more influence in the world when I live in United States of America than I live in Israel. If I would live in Israel, I won't be able to send my people to Arab countries. And I know it very much firsthand. My husband, as you know, grew up in Morocco. In Morocco, they knew that Chabad obviously was Jewish, and they knew that we had ties in Israel, but the king kind of covered it up, because the Rebbe was in America. If the Rebbe was in Israel, for sure they wouldn't allow Chabad there. And whenever people come from the Sochnut, people that came to Morocco, the Chabad rabbis always were very careful not to speak with them in public. And one time, my husband told me, there was, I don't know how many years ago it was, maybe in the 60s, one of the Sochnut people came and they had like a party. It was maybe Yotet Kislev, whatever. And he was sitting there and he was sitting and speaking to one of the Chabad rabbis. My father-in-law made sure not to speak with him during that event. He was afraid, he knew that we shouldn't, maybe that rabbi didn't realize or whatever. I don't know exactly what name it was, but doesn't matter what the rabbi was. And they didn't think nobody noticed because they were just Jewish people in the shul. That's what they thought. The following day, that rabbi received a letter from the Moroccan government that he better pick up and leave Morocco at once. Why? Because he was speaking too long to the guy from the Sochnut from Israel. And they wrote the letter, my father-in-law, since he was in charge of the whole operation in Morocco, they phoned the Rebbe, they asked the Rebbe, what should they do? Should they try to explain that they have nothing against Morocco, they are not trying to pair up against Morocco with Israel, something like that? And the Rebbe said, it's better not to start to do anything and let that rabbi leave, because otherwise it will damage the whole work of Chabad in Morocco. So that rabbi had to pack his family and his belongings and had to leave, I don't know, within a day, within a few days or whatever it is. So I'm just giving an example that I know firsthand from my husband's family, that if the Rebbe lived in Israel, he wouldn't be able to do, you know, to the whole world. So the Rebbe explained to him, he wants very much to be there, but he wants all the Jewish people to go to Israel first, then he'll come. And the Rebbe said also in other that people told him, go visit. And the Rebbe said, for me, Israel is not a museum. If I'll go, I won't be able to leave. He'll have to stay. So I know it was very painful for the Rebbe. The Rebbe loved Israel. There was a known story of some guy that spoke with the Rebbe in a private audience. And he told the Rebbe he cannot give a class. I'm thinking he lived in Yerushalayim. I don't know where. And he can't give a class because there's no bus that goes. And the Rebbe looked at him and the Rebbe said, isn't there a bus, Eged or Dan, you know, whatever the company is, that there is a bus in this time, I think there is a bus that you could take a bus to go. And the guy was like, he was shocked, like how the Rebbe knows times of buses, obviously it's divine. Then when he came back to Israel from New York, he found out, yes, it was, there was a bus like that. And he started taking the bus to give the class. So it's amazing, you know, I don't know, Rebbe knew it from newsletters, from newspapers. I don't know how the Rebbe got the info he got. He had, but he knew everything about Israel and he loved Israel. He sent so many American families to Israel all the time, encouraged Aliyah and so on and so forth to Israel. But so anyway, so thank you for reminding me that story that the Rebbe said, yeah, that's a true Jewish leader is to save the people first. If you're going to a danger, just say, Acharai, after me, you enter the danger first. And then you tell people to enter. You don't send your children, oh, go, it's dark, go, then mommy will come. You go there first. You're trying a new food. You don't know if it's salty, if it's hot. You don't know, you know, you try on your lips, then you give the baby. You don't let the baby burn their mouth. You always do yourself first. You are the leader. You try something you're not sure, you try on your own, then you give the people. And if you have to say it, everybody, then you go. Very big lesson in leadership.
Thank you for sharing.
Yeah, my pleasure. Yeah, thank you for remembering that. I forgot it already. Something else, girls, you want to share?
Thank you.
My pleasure. It's getting already a little bit late. So I think we'll stop here. But we want to, and we're going to continue. I think it's a good series, Women as Leaders. You know, perhaps we'll do another time something else. God willing, probably there's a whole class we can do about, you know, Miriam, the things that she had done, and so many. And it's good to remember. But the main thing is, to remember and to know, not just to remember someone else, to remember that we are those leaders, girls. We are the leaders that God wants us to be the leaders, as Eugene
has mentioned. Every woman is a leader.
And it doesn't matter, right, who we are, if we are an official teacher, an official this, an official that. True leaders leading by example, as we saw all these women around Moshe's life. They weren't given the job of being leaders, but they did things that endangered their life. They did things that they felt that was important. They spoke to their parents. They spoke to leaders. They did things that were amazing that many people wouldn't do because they had those leadership skills and they knew that they had to make a difference. And that's what the Rebbe said in that sicha that I've listened, like I told you, we tried to listen at night, you know, Rebbe sicha, the Rebbe said, many of them are the early years, like in the 60s, and the Rebbe's voice, the Rebbe speaks very quickly, the Rebbe's voice is so young, very interesting to hear, but it's the same thing. And the Rebbe was saying that the women of this generation have those qualities of leadership and we have to use it. Each one has to use it. It doesn't matter how old we are, because the Rebbe said you learn even from Miriam, a little five-year-old girl, had that understanding. As we know, we have the Bina Yetera, Nitna Baisha, you tell me Baish. Women have that special understanding, the special intuition, if we may say that. We understand, we know, that's why we become Bat Mitzvah a year earlier, but we have to use it for the right thing and not to be shy and do what is right.
And yeah. Maybe no.
Every woman is a leader.
And I would every like woman. To add, oh, sorry, Sanya.
No, sorry. I says every woman is a leader.
Right.
Every woman, the household, she's a finance minister, she's an economic minister, she's an educator, she's the leader of the house.
100%.
So every woman is a leader.
The house and the community. That's that a lot.
We start first at the house, you know.
And then it goes.
Not everybody can be a leader in a community, but every woman can be a leader in her own home.
Thank you, Fanny. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Yes, Susie?
I wanted to add that maybe they saw the truth, all of them.
Those women around Moshe's life, you mean Tzipora and Miriam and Yocheved and Batya?
Even though the facts were what was surrounding them, whether it was a decree of Pharaoh and everything around, but they saw the truth. They saw what was really important.
100%, they did. They did, and they brought it. That's what they were saying. Was, you see, you have to act on it. And they understood. It wasn't just like a feeling. They understood, and they knew that it was dangerous, and they found ways. Miriam wanted to save her little brother, so she decided, oh, she will tell. She saw the baby's not nursing. She says, oh, do you want me to help you, princess? I know a woman that had a baby. I'm going to go try to find one of the Me'aibriot from the Jewish, because she saw he doesn't want to have any milk from the Egyptian lady. She says, well, let me find a Jewish woman. That she said, sure. And she goes, she found her mother. It's like when you look at it, like it's like a story that somebody made up, but you know, like you couldn't write a better story, a cover story, but it's amazing. And because, yeah, and they saw, because Miriam was a prophetess, Yetan Neviyah. She knew that the Redeemer will be born. And by not having babies, the Redeemer will not going to be born. So that's what brought the Redeemer. And she was the one that pushed it. It was because of her. And that's what the Rebbe says in that Sicha, as Mrs. Wedger is saying, that every woman is a leader. That's true. And the Rebbe is saying, not just every woman is a leader, even little girls. That's where little girls should start lighting candles when they're three. We should use our leadership skills. And as I added, leadership skills doesn't mean that we have to be a CEO and a prime minister and this and to be up there and so on. Many times this is not good leadership. It doesn't mean it's a leader. It's many times a dictator or somebody who rules, who makes rules. But do we follow them? Do we look up to them? Do we want to be like them? True leaders is when you want to emulate them, when they have, you know, good humans and they have good traits and so on and so forth, as you all know what we mean.
Yeah.
I like all the beautiful. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, it was a very good class, Baruch Hashem. We all learned a lot.
Thank you.
Like myself, I learned a lot with it.
It was wonderful class.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for your.
Thank you. And Shabbat Shalom.
And Shabbat Shalom. We should have a good night. And all the best. And a lot of gesund. And let's hope that no more cases. Everybody should be well. I want to say, Baruch, we have a young Jewish boy who used to come to our camp.
Yeah.
He's 39 years old, which I think is very young, and he's fighting for his life. He got corona in a very bad way. They put him in induced coma today.
Where is he, in Calgary?
Abraham in Calgary, yeah. Avraham Ben Donia. Avraham Ben Donia, he should have a refuah shlema. His little kids used to come to camp. Aliyah, you would know them. You know him.
Wow.
Steinberg.
Who?
Russian-Israeli community.
Spengler?
Steinberg, yeah. Michael and Donia are the parents. Rosh Lema, Bezat Hashem. I don't know if he's in Foothills, one of the hospitals here, and today the father called to say that they're doing that. And
Rochel, maybe you can provide us with his Hebrew name.
Yeah, so can... Abraham.
Abraham.
Abraham ben Donia.
Donia. Okay. Mother, thank you, Rochel.
Abraham ben Donia. Yeah, he should have Rosh Lema. And Rav, also the one from Jaynet, Abraham, Chaim, Shneur Zalman, Yehuda, Ben Yehinda, Yochevet, Omei, should have also reposh Lema. She's been well and really sick for 9 months, also from Corona, young man, also in his 30s, early 40s, should be well. So many complications, God willing, well. Shem Yishmor, and Hashem Shishmor, all of us, and everybody who is well should not get sick, and every sick should be well. And we should go out from this pandemic and we should be well and have a good Shabbos.
Oy, amen.
Thank you. Good Shabbos.
You're all amazing leaders. Let's use it. Take care.
Shalom.
Shabbat shalom. Shabbat shalom.
Shabbat shalom.
Bye. Thank you for joining. Shabbat shalom. Bye-bye. Thank you.
Thank you.
So nice of you, way from Toronto.